was playing backstage with this, and this is absolutely mind-blowing. I'm Robert Scoble, and I'm just joining up with VR to cover this piece of space, virtual reality. Glad to see so many people made it this morning after being out on the town in New Orleans. So, first of all, how many people here have even had a 15-minute demo in one of the high-end headsets, just to give me a sense, like HTC Vive, Oculus Rift, or something like PlayStation VR? So this is a very skewed audience, which is great. I think we can get really nerdy pretty quickly without having to explain what VR is in a lot of depth. Why do we need a sensor like this? Why does HTC's controllers or the Oculus Rift controllers not even? Why do we need a new optical sensor?
Well, I think what people want when they put on a big opaque headset is to feel totally transported to the world. And I think anything that's unnatural, whether it's a controller or anything that isn't your own body, it has massively disappointed that. So there's still a place sometimes for tools, but they're in the context of your hand and how you use them. But I think that the moment you see your hands move exactly as they do, it creates something that isn't a passive 3D experience, like watching a 3D movie. It suddenly becomes it makes you feel like you're being teleported into the world. And that's the VR that everyone deserves.
Today, if you want to do this, you have to have an Oculus Rift or even a Gear VR or something. And then you have to buy a $79 developer kit and strap that on the front of this, right? When are we going to get it built into the headset where we get these optical sensors that look at our hands built in and we don't have to worry about strapping it on and aligning it properly, stuff like that?
Yes, sir. One of the things that is really cool about our approach is we use really inexpensive off-the-shelf hardware that costs just a few dollars and just regular cameras. So they can be embedded in any device, even if your headsets or air headsets get thin at some point. Right now, obviously, size is a major constraint. They're pretty big, but we're working with any of the biggest OEMs right now to embed this. I think for the first generation devices like Oculus and Sony, we'll see this in the second generation products probably. But for the many, many OEMs that are targeting all-in-one or mobile VR, many are targeting for launch at the end of this year, we'll probably see at least two or three of those devices. Because once you start talking about mobility and portability, with the camera really the only input that is always with someone, but also that approaches the level of immersion that people expect from VR.
If we jump 5 years into the future, I have a feeling we're going to be wearing a piece of glass, whether it's from Magic Leap or Meta or Oculus or Facebook or Apple or Microsoft's HoloLens, version 3. And those things, I expect, are going to have sensors like this built in. There's competitive approaches to Leap Motion, right? But how do you see the market shaking out in terms of hand-based sensors like this? There's going to be a variety of sensors on glasses.
Yeah, I will say I'm incredibly excited about AR. I think that in some ways, I think VR should focus on immersion, and that's one of the reasons why I believe so strongly in power of hands in that context, because I don't think an opaque headset should try to be like a workplace tool, and if that's what it's talking about best of. But on the other hand, I think that AR has the potential to disrupt everything and be a massive disruptive both to consumer experiences but also to workplace. Because once you can project something over the environment that is physically indistinguishable, that sort of is the end almost of all consumer electronics that we know. And in some ways, it's also the end of time and space. Like my children can grow up with a child projected in their room who lives in Iraq or something. So that has massive implications, but you absolutely need your hands for those things too. Just in a different way. So right now, we think that in terms of the actual tracking of the hands figures, for VR and AR, you have to track them incredibly fast. You have to build still figures. You have to be able to do things like grab an object and move it. And right now, we're really the only company that has that level of speed and accuracy. But On the other hand, because we focus so much on tracking hands and fingers, we don't try to track a root for objects. That's where other technology is better. So there are lots of interesting work being done in tracking rooms, objects, and pre-scanning things. And the best thing is a combination of those where someone else runs voice recognition for text input, someone else does object scanning to tell us that there's a table there. And then we do the hand tracking to let the person touch the thing on the table. That's what we're tracking there. So we absolutely focusing on one very, very hard problem that is so hard that it's been unsolved for decades, really. But other people are really important parts of the end product.
Why can't you just use the camera that's in like the HTC Vive? I mean, it has a little camera in it. Why do I need a sensor array like the one you're building?
Yeah, and you almost can't use it. So the sensors we use are actually VGA, so very, very low resolution. But we really believe that it should work in total darkness, also in very high light. So we like to have a few infrared LEDs, and we, because of that, the sensor has to be able to see infrared. So the good thing is it's extremely small, and because these sorts of things will fall in price and size, especially fight the price of products, so they'll just continue to get more available.
You already have a prototype of one that's going to be built into a headset that looks like a strip of chewing gum.
Yeah, it's incredible how small these things are. And I guess if you think about sort of 10 megapixel plus sensors that are in phones today, those are really small. Our sensor is something that is, you know, quarter magnitude, low resolution. So that gives you an idea of how tiny the device is that's embedded into it.
Technically, I mean, how fast is the frame rate? How important is that?
We're very obsessive about frame rate because we think that, especially in VR, any latency not only destroys that sensor because user has to think this is their own app. And that means that you need high frame rate, in our case, at least 120 FPS. You want extremely low latency, in our case, you know, under 5 milliseconds usually. And you have to track all of the joints and fingers. And even when you can't see them. So if I grab it like this, and my own human eyes can't see if I grab it or releasing, we have to know that anyways. Because that's how you interact with the world. And we don't want to have to tell people, here's the right way to grab this, here's the wrong way to grab this, because that destroys the magic of physical experience. The magic of physical experience is that every single person can grab their own subtly different way, and it just works. And so we spend a lot of time, and even for very simple things to us as humans, like grabbing, we've had to train with 70,000 plus permutations in how people grab just to get that action prototype. So we're being very, very thoughtful about all the little tiny things that go into people forgetting that that is their digital hand and saying, wow, that's not my digital hand, that's my physical hand. That's what we want people to forget when they put on the headset that they're not in their bedroom or their living room, they're being teleported to a different place.
Backstage, when I turn my hand over, I got a menu off of my fingers. Are you building a software kit that helps developers build that kind of UI into their apps?
Yeah, we're working on that in a few ways. One is by exercising a level of thought leadership in terms of thinking through what are some problems with VR right now that can be solved by the internet of things. And I think menus are one because you don't have a file bar or anything in VR anymore, you wouldn't want one. Something universal, like I turn my hand this way, and then the menu pops out around here. And then, potentially, it could display certain high-level information, like email alerts, and I could decide based on that if it's important enough to leave the immersive environment or not. And then if I want to, I could push a button there. But also, that could become the universal way of accessing the control panel in a given application. So, in that video with the box application, if someone turns their hand this way, there's a bar where they can select different shapes. So we think that in VR it's really important that there are certain universal things. For most things, we can get away with picking things that are direct physical metaphors, and that way you don't have to have a tutorial, you don't have to teach people sign language. But for some things, you have to have certain gestures, and for those gestures, we want it to be as obvious as possible.
Yeah. you know, looking at the, I had a demo of the Meta augmented reality glass and Magic Leap is similar. They're going to have eye sensors and a visual way of putting this stuff on the real world. And then they have a whole bunch of sensor arrays to map out the world, like you said. Some are based on like the Google Tango technology. In fact, they have Meta hired two of the guys who built Google's Tango technology, which most of us don't even have yet on our phone.
Yeah.
That's coming next month at Google I.O. Where do you see this? What should developers pay attention to in this world that's coming? Because right now, it's such early days in terms of building a user interface for this new virtual world and soon this augmented reality world where we have to put things on top of the real world and make it human.
Yeah, and we're in a fortunate position because we talk to so many different OEMs. And one thing that I think we have a unique insight to is that sort of mirror companies that most people think of, like Sony and Oculus and Vive, or Valve, those are really just sort of the very, very tip of the iceberg. And really almost every major technology company in the world, whether it's like large Chinese companies like Tencent or Alibaba, or traditional hardware companies like South Korea or Taiwan or the US, anyone that you can name off the top of your head has some mirror program. And many of them are going to fail, of course, but I've been impressed with how quickly they've all sort of synchronized around the middle ground, which is not slotted mobile, which I think is a sort of relatively weak experience because you don't want to, if you load your VR headset to someone, you don't want to have to give your phone, you don't want to like get a text message and pull it out of the environment. But on the other hand, you shouldn't have to have a $3,000 gaming computer and accessories all over your room. So I think a lot of the biggest companies that don't want to miss out on the next platform are thinking about a sort of all-in-one headset that has its own little processor, doesn't need to be connected to a $3,000 gaming computer, but is still an independent device that they can sell to people and control the experience. And we're going to see a lot of those coming out towards the middle and end of this year. And I think that will be probably the biggest part of the market pretty quickly. And it's also a big focus for us in terms of pounds, because again, around. Once I have any sort of mobility, what are most powerful 3D devices that I always have with me? And usually people have their hands up when they go outside.
When do you think the consumer is going to get a headset with your style of hand control? In other words, touchless control is really cool.
Yeah, I think that people see your headsets with hand control of them around the end of this year, probably, several. And we are working with companies that some companies are going to be aggressive at least for the end of this year, others may take a few more years. But I think everyone agrees that seeing your hands is sort of the ultimate state of immersion in VR. And that doesn't necessarily mean that there's no other place for other types of devices. If you look at and you're in a stationary position, there are times when it might be better to use a tool at also have. But hands are the sort of base de facto primary interaction. And then I'm really excited about air as well. I think air is an entirely different inflection point. And I think that requires hands not only because you're portable, but also because the core part of the experience is being able to touch the things you see around you. And it would be such a shame if we had technology that could make us see anything exactly like real life, but we couldn't touch it. We had to touch the side of our head to interact with it. That would be a big shame.
I could talk to you for hours. Unfortunately, we have 20 minutes. That's it. Thank you so much. Thanks for getting up early this morning. Okay.